Hello again, ladies, gentlemen, and fellow non-binary daisies. So, as you all know, PSAs aren't my only interest. I have many interests, in fact, art and animation being two pretty big ones. And honestly, that being said, I'm surprised this idea wasn't what I thought of myself, but it unequivocally won the poll, so I guess that's what we're doing today. Roll the intro, baby.
Yo sé que eres chiquito y que sabes ver que no todas las cosas se pueden creer. Si te ofrecen drogas, te van a decir que se siente bien padre, que te vas a reír.
¡No es cierto! ¡No hagas caso, no es cierto!
Lo que esa gente no te quiere decir es que si usas drogas te vas a confundir. Que hacen daño a tu cuerpo. Que envenenan tu cuerpo.
¡Vive sin drogas!
Fundación Azteca. Sin drogas.
I actually really like the rap of this PSA. It's a really trippy and interesting beat. But that's about the only part of this PSA that I unironically enjoy. Everything else about it? Well, let's just say it's iconic in Mexico, but not for the reason you'd think. It's not iconic because they're good, but rather just how bizarre it is. I mean, even its premise is so fucking weird because this is directed towards fucking preschoolers with a rap telling them to avoid drugs. I know drugs in the public are a serious problem in Mexico, but do preschoolers really need this information? And if this PSA truly needed to be made, did it have to be the ugliest fucking CGI possible? I get it, this was made in the 90s, but even if it wasn't so poorly made, the CGI is still fucking ugly as hell.
You blow your snotty nose, another tree goes down. Clear 100 acres when you sneeze. Another box of Kleenex, one more forest gun.
There's wax to make from the trees we take, and the stumps are all that we leave.
The virgin forest is what we love to use to make the Kleenex soft for your nose.
Get out the birds, the endangered herds. Bears and wolves hit the road. For there's no tree we won't clear cut and then load. We'll fill the boxes and kill the foxes to wipe your nose when you sneeze.
And we'll cut them all.
Yes, we'll cut them all.
We'll
clear cut
them all
right down to the last
I talked about this one in my first ever PSA collab, that being with the lovely Butch Cavalier Spaniel lady DJ Mutt. We both agreed we loved it because it's so goddamn goofy. Sure, one of my viewers has since informed me that Greenpeace weren't trying to say Kimberly Clark was fucking the forests by referring to the forests as virgin forests. Rather, they were using forestry jargon for untouched forests. But even so, they had to have known the fucking innuendo. People would notice. Still, it's quite a funny PSA, even if most of that humor is unintentional. This PSA is so stupid and looks like a surreal minimalist art project, but that's part of why I love it. By the way, almost all of Above the Influences PSAs are unintentionally hilarious and stupidly disgusting at worst, which makes sense since it was an anti-weed campaign running into the late 2000s. I don't have a deadpan sprite, so I hope my voice carries my attitude towards this campaign. But, back to this PSA in particular. The way the dog just gives up on his owner is just too funny to me, even telling him you disappoint me. Jesus fucking Christ, you know you're a failure in life when even your dog is disappointed in you. And then, to just further piss on this dude even more, he walks off like, fuck you, and fuck this shit, I'm out. Oh, Above the Influence, you were such a shitty campaign. But at least you brought the PSA community so many unintentional comedy gems. Fun fact, I came very close to putting this on my top 20 unintentionally funny PSAs countdown, but I ended up deciding against it. Don't get me wrong, the bombing itself is hilariously edgy and over the top, and the way it's designed looks like something I'd see in a 2008 YouTube poop. But on the other hand, it is kind of disconcerting to see the Smurf Village bombed and see the blue creatures scream in terror as baby Smurf helplessly cries. It'd most likely be even more disconcerting to residents of Belgium, considering the Smurfs are very commonly recognized as children's characters there, since, you know, Peo was a Belgian cartoonist. Also, aside from the fact that it's incredibly shocking, it also didn't end up on me and DJ Mutt's collab, since I may or may not be planning a sequel to the unintentionally funny PSAs countdown.
So look, a house! And it's made of candy!
Chocolate cakes!
And the windows are made of toffee!
I want the roof!
I want...
So how's my plump little Gretel?
How do you do it? You eat as much as a boy.
Don't eat too much or you'll get fat.
Gretel?
Well, I'd like to say this is the sickest interpretation of Hansel and Gretel I've ever seen in a PSA, but unfortunately it is not. But it does come pretty fucking close. I watched this a few times back in sixth grade, but it was only on the fifth watch that I saw, or rather heard, what made this PSA so sickening. Gretel fucking purging herself in the background as her brother looks on in confusion. It made this PSA, which was, up until that point, really fucking tame, a lot more unnerving. Also, the implications this PSA made, that the parents unknowingly caused Gretel to develop an eating disorder, are incredibly disturbing in and of themselves.
Zach, she's been on the nectar all night.
She's fine, Noel. Right?
Dude, couch, water, pizza.
I thought you were my wingman.
I am, dude. You should thank me.
She's totally into it.
Doesn't count when you're wrecked. Hammered equals date rape.
For reals?
For reals.
Wow. Now I feel like a total woodpecker head.
Buzz off. This isn't a mating dance.
Hey, chill. Let's get bird shit-faced and party.
You chill and keep your hands off her tail feathers.
Damn. Talk about buzzkills.
Damn. Talk about not knowing when it's time to bail.
Time to fly the coop, hive hole.
Dude. Did you just post a comment about how tasty Kim's breast looks in her bird bath suit?
Yeah, so?
So? That's a dick move. Delete it before she sees it.
Shouldn't post photos like that if you're gonna egg your pants about the comments.
Wrong. It's not her job to keep you from being a douche.
Okay, I'm deleting it. Sorry, I didn't think.
That's right. You didn't think. B-brain.
Glad I'm not the only one who gets huge regular show vibes from both these PSAs, especially the second one. I really dig the concept of a world populated entirely by birds and bees. This actually seems like such a good idea for a TV series. But no, instead we've got pervy birds and bees trying to get in each other's pants, only for their friends to rightfully cockblock. Oh wait, not sure that term works, considering I'm pretty sure bees and most birds don't have penises, but you get what I mean. Also, the fact that this knockoff Mordecai-ass blue jay in the second PSA told his bee friend that it's a dick move to make a perverted comment on a female friend's post made me ponder this question. What is it with Canadian PSAs and just casually dropping words us Americans would consider swears that'd get the PSA banned if it aired on television? Just last countdown, we had a dude screaming fuck, which isn't the only Canadian PSA I've heard just casually drop an F-bomb, surprisingly. One would think for a country as known for being friendly and cordial as Canada, they'd be a bit more stringent with the language used. Or maybe the American FCC is just a bunch of prudes behind the times. What the fuck do I know? Well, if it's about protecting the children's innocence, hey, to the kids watching this here countdown, shit, ass motherfucker tits.
The boy who didn't stop, look, and listen. Before his leg was bent backwards, He loved to play football all day, but the boy didn't cross in a safe place where he could see cars come his way. He then didn't stop, look, and listen. A car hit him at quite a pace. And now he cannot play football, because his leg broke in more than one place. The girl who didn't dress bright in the dark. She always liked to look her best, so didn't wear a nice bright vest or any clothing that was bright when she was out at nearly night. But traffic couldn't see her, see. And now she isn't so trendy. A car drove right into her guts and covered her with bruisey cuts. The boy who didn't look for a safe place to cross. He couldn't be bothered to walk to a place where cars could be seen from a nice open space. So he crossed the road right next to a bend. Now his arm for some while would be struggling to mend. A car cannot dodge what it cannot see, so flatten the boy. Unfortunately, now he can't swim, dress himself, or go-kart, because his arm is all limp and falling apart. Always cross where you can see what's coming.
Forgot about my cluster bleep joke in the last entry. Good, that shit took way too much effort for a stupid joke about censorship. Anyways, damn, we've got one of the last truly creepy PSA campaigns that Think ever made. Back to the Past famously hated that another entry on this PSA countdown was replaced by this campaign, and while I personally have mixed feelings on it. On one hand, it's incredibly effective, with the victims of the road looking borderline dead compared to the rest of the kids, and even themselves in the memories. But on the other hand, it's such a tonal whiplash from the campaign that came before it, that it seems like Think was just trying to prove they hadn't lost their edge after a moment of doubt. I don't know, it just seems like a bit of overcompensation on Think's end.
Roddy, come on out from under there.
No!
Come on.
I saw a monster in the closet.
There is no such thing as monsters.
But I saw it.
Jeff, could you come up here?
Okay, pal, it's time for bed. There's no such thing as monsters.
The monster is real.
Can we get much higher?
So high.
Okay, I'll stop. I just had to get it out of my system. Real talk though, this is one of the most shocking twists I've ever seen in a PSA, though surprisingly not the only American gun PSA in which I've seen a kid shoot themselves in the head. You wouldn't expect it from a PSA with such a storybook-like, simplistic art style either, Which is honestly, I feel, what makes this PSA show so shocking. You think this will be a wholesome story about a boy facing his fears and finding out there's no such thing as monsters, but no, instead we get him literally going out with a bang.
The monster in the closet absolutely is real, baby, and you left the perfect opportunity for it to attack your kid. Okay, that was mean, even for me. But seriously, keep your guns locked up and out of the reach of your children, unless, you know, you want them to fucking fuck around and find out.
Nice view from up here, Petunia.
Yes, very nice, Joe. One tire's kill. One tire's kill. Are our tires worn, Joe?
Yeah, I wouldn't think so, Petunia.
Well, I expect you've looked. You have looked, haven't you, Joe? Joe, have you looked at our tires?
Yes.
Recently, Joe.
Nice view from up here, Petunia.
Joe, are our tires worn?
Not worn, Petunia. They're a bit smooth.
Oh, that's nice.
Ah, kicking it old school with this one. So, my story with this PSA. This is one of the first creepy animated PSAs I've ever seen, and I specifically remember watching this for the first time one Halloween night back when I was in 6th grade. It was 11 o'clock at night, and everyone else in the house was asleep. Meanwhile, I had a phone without a SIM card connected to my home's Wi-Fi, and I was laying on my bedroom floor. It was on this phone that I was watching the PSA community classic, Hello I'm a Pizza's Top 50 Scariest Public Information Films, The Redux. That night was one of my most formative experiences in my journey into the rabbit hole of PSAs on YouTube, and to this day, every Halloween at night, I still make an attempt to return to that old video, even as I approach my 20s and the video nears being a decade old. Anyways, that story about one of my most beloved memories of being a member of the PSA community aside, this PSA, well, it was shocking, I'll give you that. It's always shocking to see any form of media kill off the protagonists, especially in a series as typically lighthearted as fucking Joe and Petunia. And the transition from a cartoon to a real-life car crash just did not hold back on demonstrating how real your mortality really is. The moment the characters transition into the real world is the moment they fucking die horribly, and they never make an appearance after this PSA. So, they were killed off in it. This PSA killed off Joe and Petunia for good. It sounds stupid, but this PSA that pre-fucking dates me by 25 years, this PSA about fucking worn tires of all things, was arguably the first thing to ever make me question my existence, to ever make me seriously confront my own mortality. And for a 6th grader, that was pretty heavy. But ultimately, it was a good thing. Because truth be told, we all need that reality check at some point. And my reality check was this PSA.
Charlie says that if ever you see a box of matches lying around, tell Mummy because they can hurt you. day when my dad went fishing, he took Charlie and me along. While he was fishing, we started having fun with the puddles. Dad shouted, "Come back here!" But just then, Charlie tried to do an extra big jump, and he went over the edge and into the water. Charlie nearly drowned. It was very lucky for him, he caught on the line. Charlie says next time we go fishing, we should stay very close to Dad where he can look after us. And he hopes that when you go near the water, you'll stay close to a grown-up too. Charlie says that stoves are dangerous to go close to because there are so many hot things there that can hurt you. Charlie says he knows now that it's dangerous to pull the tablecloth because the hot water from the teapot hurts him very much. Charlie and I were in the park. Then this man came up and said, "Would I like to see some puppies?" And I said yes. And I was going to go, but Charlie stopped me. Charlie's reminded me, my mum says I shouldn't go off with people I don't know. Then the man went away. We went and told Mummy, and she said we'd been very good. I got an apple and Charlie got something he likes. He says never go anywhere with men or ladies you don't know. Charlie and I were out the back when Vera and Dave came by and said, "Come along for a picnic." And I was going, but Charlie said, he says I'd better tell Mum where I'm going. So we told him to wait while we went and asked. But Mum was talking to the milkman. And she talked such a long time that when I had asked her and she'd said yes, the others had gone. Mum asked us why we hadn't gone, and when I told her, she said we'd been good for not going, and would we like a day out with her instead?
Meow, 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 meow. question.
Charlie says always tell your mummy before you go off somewhere so she knows who you are with.
This series is a classic, so obviously I was going to make this a sextuple feature. The six PSAs all follow the same basic premise, that being one of these two. Either Tony is about to do something dangerous, and Charlie meows a reminder not to do said dangerous thing, which Tony follows. He's stopped Tony from being abducted, playing with matches, and going AWOL from his mom's house. However, Charlie himself has done rather foolish things, in which his stupidity has caused him to be burnt by steam, scalded by a teapot, and almost fucking drowned. Obviously, no serious harm happens to either Tony or Charlie, since, although these are UK PSAs from the 70s, they were still directed at young children. Then again, these were made the same year Lonely Water came out, so I could be wrong about the 70s UK TV authority not wanting to scare the shit out of kids.
We'll be right back.
I've talked about this PSA a few times. The first time was back in Season 3 with the top 25 scariest Asian PSAs. The second was on my top 50 scariest South and Southeast Asian PSAs countdown. And I'm talking about it right now, which would make it my third. And while the CGI in this PSA isn't all that pretty, you know, makes sense considering, for a country like Nepal, which is incredibly poor, this had to be really fucking expensive. Less than desirable CGI aside, the storyline and characters absolutely make up for it. That restaurant owner is fucking sick. It's not common you see the animal abuser in a PSA grin at his fucking kill. In fact, I think the only other PSA I've ever seen the villain grin at their animal kill were the kids in Hunters by Anda. And this man's grin sends chills down my spine. He shows no remorse for Snow, for fucking poisoning the poor dog while he's barely hanging on from the beatings he's taken. And it breaks my heart that Snow here died for no other fucking reason than that he wanted to make things up to his owner for popping her zebra toy. It's fucking rough, dude.
At this point, you think she's going somewhere, bud? I don't think she's going nowhere, you get me? Easy, bub. You in trouble now, man.
While I hate the fact that the video games cause violence argument isn't just an American thing, I love the idea of a PSA switching between a 2000s PS2 game's graphics and live action to hammer in the ramifications of engaging in knife crime, which is a huge problem in the UK. You see, we've all got our national crime to be ashamed of. Us Americans have school shootings, you Brits have street stabbings, and on top of that, you guys also are home to Wales, which has sheep screwings. Okay, that was a low blow, I must admit. Anyways, back to the PSA. The argument leading up to the knife fight is the most chavvy dialogue I've ever heard, and yes, I'm aware that my usage of the term chav makes me sound just as British as a lot of my viewers, but I don't care. The stabbing itself that results after these two chavs pull a knife on each other is quite disconcerting, especially when we see the life drain out of the eyes of the stabbing victim. All in all, a pretty well done PSA.
Just stop, look and listen, and we're staying alive, staying alive. Ah, 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 staying alive. it's not light. Where's something bright? Put it on your left. Put it on your right. Can't see by traffic, morning and night. Woo, woo, woo.
You know your own street, and everyone you meet. You know which dogs bark. The best way to the park is your neighborhood. That's where you feel good. Though you know the road well, still you never can tell. You've got to be wise. You could be surprised. On the roads they're home. Stop, think, then go. Woo 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 woo.
Ah, good to see these little guys again. I'm not British, nor was I alive in the late 90s or early 2000s, so why do I recognize these PSAs? Well, they just so happened to be Back to the Past's... Well, I don't know if it's his favorite, but I know it's one of his favorite think campaigns. And if you know anything about my idol in the PSA community, and the Welshman whose top 10s inspired this whole series, you'd know he famously hated most think campaigns. This was because, after a moment of doubt, they went on such a sharp decline in quality, and I assume this is what essentially started Back to the Past's massive hate boner he'd expressed for Think throughout the top 10 series. But as big as his hate boner for Think was, he loved these hedgehogs dearly. And honestly, despite this arguably being Think's tamest series of PSAs, these hedgehogs have such a charming art style and a catchy selection of songs that they hold a special place in my heart too. I can understand why he was such a huge fan of them. See, Think, PSAs don't need to be graphic to be effective. If done right, it can absolutely help, but it's not a necessity. In fact, many British people who grew up in the late 90s and early 2000s still think these are incredibly effective PSAs. Also, completely unrelated, but I think since Back to the Past has moved on from PSA-related content, hence why I've referred to the top 10 series in the past tense, he'd see the humor in his spiritual successor being a sheep, you know, with him being a Welshman and all. Also, if you happen to be watching this though, dude, don't take that joke personally. Also, huge fan, and I owe a lot of my series to you.
What's this? Have you had a hard day, have you? Hey, you've been sitting all day watching telly? Who's touched my videos? I said who's messed up my videos? Don't just sit there when I'm talking to you. Get out! Start backing your ideas up, son. Hey, I'm telling you. Now what the hell are you up to? Look at the state of this place! Hey, look at the state of it! Look at it!
Ow!
What did I tell you about running indoors? Right? What did I tell you? Where are you? Here you are. What are you up to? I just asked you what you're up to.
I'm
trying. Let me do this. You dirty bastard! Get out! That's it, get going, you fucking run! Get out of here!
Well, well, well. I've talked about this PSA so many times, but even though this would be my fifth time talking about it, I can't find much fault with it. It takes the style of Who Framed Roger Rabbit, that being the iconic mix of live action and animation, to a very twisted extreme. I'm hating myself for not putting this guy on my top 15 despised PSA villains countdown, because good god, is this guy a piece of shit to his son. Even if the violence is initially very cartoony, it's still not easy to watch at all because of how the dad's extremely abusive behavior bleeds into it. In fact, it makes the reveal that this was a real child all the more unsettling. All in all, a controversial, but still, as usual, very well done PSA from the NSPCC.
Yeah. Dame 2. Dame 2.
Get it.
closet.
What about that? What about that? What about
by far my favorite Russian PSA campaign, much more enjoyable than that horrific anti-drug PSA that showed a man hanging himself. It's the perfect demonstration of fuck around, find out, and it never gets more graphic than it needs to. Of course, it doesn't mean these forever get off scot-free with fucking around on trains. You can always expect their dumbassery to at least cost them an arm and a prison sentence, and at the worst, they get fucking eaten alive. The animation style is very lively and fluid, which only makes the mood whiplash at the end of most of these PSAs that much more effective. Though, I'd binge the hell out of this series if it were an actual show. Stop motion does indeed count as animation, and this PSA against shark fin soup does it beautifully. Each spoon has its own drawing, and while it starts with happy piano music and a wedding scene on each spoon, it quickly devolves into an incredibly saddening and bloody scene of sharks being slaughtered horrifically for their fins, which are consumed in soup in many Asian nations. And as the PSA shows, not the whole shark, not even half of it, just the fins. Started with a white wedding and ended with blood in the water. Oh hey, two song references. But still, I hadn't seen this PSA prior to this year, but I'm glad that me and other people
are talking more about it, because it's so underrated.
Somewhere in this vast place, there's a small group of islands known as the Faroe Islands. No one knows why, but once a year, large groups of pilot whales return here. The islanders look forward to their visit each year and prepare a special homecoming for them. First of all, they herd the whales into the harbor. Then they harpoon them. And then cut them up with hunting knives while they're still alive. The noise you can hear is the whale screaming as it experiences this horrific death. The more the whales scream, the more the crowd seem to enjoy it. Meat is then distributed to the crowd, and once their freezers are crammed full, the rest is left on the beach to rot.
This one's another classic I remember seeing for the first time that fateful Halloween night. It's horrifying, but I can't deny it's a classic. I absolutely love the art style of this PSA, though I do have a question. How in God's name did this, of all things, get a mere PG rating? We're literally seeing whales get harpooned and cut apart while they're still alive with blood galore, while they scream in pain. And all of this is narrated excitedly by Sir Anthony Hopkins. Sure, it's in a painting style, but I'm sure this would traumatize any young kids in the late 80s unlucky enough to see this. It's one of the most jarring animated PSAs I've ever seen, and definitely going on a countdown of animal welfare PSAs if I ever do one.
Life can be tough at times. Emotions can become overwhelming and even lead to suicidal thoughts. Although it can feel very intense, it's important to remember these feelings will pass. To find out what helped Study Girl and may help you, click on the link in the description.
This one is such an underrated PSA, and one I'm hitting myself for not including on my mental health PSA countdown. Now, I'm sure a lot of you guys are aware of my struggles with mental health, specifically depression, and how oftentimes it's unfortunately a big part of my life, despite the wacky persona I put on for you guys on this channel. I don't have a sad sprite, or even one that could be described as serious. In fact, the biggest indicator of my negative feelings outside of horror and anger are my voice. Like the study girl here, my depression has often led me to contemplate ending it all before. And it wasn't even that I wanted to die. It was that I just wanted the pain to end. And real talk, it's because I have friends and family and you guys. Yes, you, my lovely viewers and members of the sheep herd, that thankfully I never acted upon these urges enough to seriously do damage to myself. And so to see such an iconic character as the Lo-Fi Girl try to end her life due to how hopeless she feels, something I'm unfortunately all too familiar with from a personal standpoint, is both shocking and heartbreaking, and I almost cried myself when she broke down. So, in case you need to hear it, to anyone in my audience watching this video, if you don't feel like your life has meaning, well, it does to me. And I may just be some sheep on the internet who reviews PSAs, but hey, I'm still someone, aren't I? So please, as hard as it may be some days, keep your head up. It will all be okay in the end.
Set fire to your hair. Poke a stick at a grizzly bear. Eat medicine that's out of date. Use your private parts as piranha bait. Dumb ways to die. So many dumb ways to die. Dumb ways to die. So many dumb ways to die. Get your toast out with a fork. Do your own electrical work. Teach yourself how to fly. Eat a 2-week-old unrefrigerated pie.
Dumb ways to die. So many dumb ways to die. Dumb ways to die. So many dumb ways to die.
Invite a psycho killer inside. Scratch a drug dealer's brand new. Take your helmet off in outer space. Use a clothes dryer as a hiding place.
Dumb ways to die. So many dumb ways to die. Dumb ways to die. So many dumb ways to die.
Keep your rattlesnake as a pet. Sell both your kidneys on the internet. Wonder, what's this red button do?
Dumb ways to die. So many dumb ways to die. Dumb ways to die. So many dumb ways to die.
Dress up like a moose during hunting season. Disturb a nest of wasps for no good reason. Stand on the edge of a train station platform. Drive around the boom gates at a level crossing. Run across the tracks between the platforms. They may not rhyme, but they're quite possibly dumbest ways to die. Be safe around trains. A message from Metro.
There's no fucking way I couldn't mention this PSA. And I'd be lying if I said I didn't love this little number. It's a classic even for newbies of the PSA community. In fact, I bet this was the first PSA a lot of you had ever seen on YouTube. And while it's considerably less graphic than many Australian PSAs, it gets its message across quite well, with each way to die getting increasingly stupider and stupider. What I love so much about this PSA is that, unlike other long PSAs I've seen, while it does go on, it doesn't feel like it takes too long to get to the point that these dangerous behaviors around trains are not only stupid, but deadly. And it's for this reason, I think, that this is arguably Australia's most well-known PSA. Surprisingly, their most popular PSA isn't an absolute bloodbath.
Ready? We rolling? Okay, Ralph, can you mark it, please?
Do you want me to click it now?
Yep, go for it. Go on.
Like that?
Brilliant.
Oh, it's like in the movies. Alrighty, so, my name's Ralph. I'm a rabbit, as you can see. I'm blind in my right eye, and, this ear. Can't hear nothing but ringing now. Yeah, it's annoying, isn't it? Yeah. So I had my fur shaved and got chemical burns up and down my back. Kind of stings, eh? But it's not a big deal. I mean, it only really hurts when I, like, breathe or move around or whatever. Ah, yeah. Ow. Yeah, that hurts. But at the end of the day, I mean, it's okay. We do it for the humans, right? They're far superior to us animals. They've even been to space. Have you ever seen a rabbit in a rocket ship? Oh, I don't think so. Point is, I'm not a space bunny. I'm a tester. My daddy was a tester. My mum, my brothers, my sisters, my kids, all testers. And they all died doing their job. Not like I will. But it's okay. Testing is what we were born to do. It makes us rabbits happy. Yeah. Oh. Time to get to work. Now I know it looks bad, but the way I see it, I'm doing my job. If just one human can have the illusion of a safer lipstick or deodorant or...
Hey, Ralphie! Psst. Ralphie! What's with the camera crew, bro?
they're just following me around, making a documentary or something.
Can you ask them to get us out of here?
Yeah, what will we see?
Come on, Ralphie, just ask them to get us out of here. I don't
want to
die, man!
Okay,
Ralphie!
Okay, I hear you. You can edit that out, right? Oh, here we go.
Hey,
don't touch me!
Oh, shit! So in closing, I'd just like to say that...
Sorry, Ralph. We're over here. Can you turn around?
Oh, sorry.
That's all right.
Is this better?
Yeah. Carry on, mate.
Okay, so, yeah, I'd just like to say to everyone out there still buying animal-tested cosmetics like eyeliner, shampoo, sunscreen, pretty much everything in your bathroom, well, without you and countries that allow animal testing, I'd be out of a job. I'd be on the streets. Well, not the streets, more like a field, I guess. You know, like a normal rabbit. But hey. It's all good.
You know what? Maybe I was wrong about America not making great PSAs anymore. Yeah, this is 3 years old, but it's still pretty recent in terms of PSAs. So, honestly, I don't consider this just a PSA. It's a fucking work of art. No joke. If I could, I would put this in a museum. Simply put, because it's such a visceral, you know, look into just the sheer horrors of animal testing. Ralph here clearly finds his job torturous, and the first things we learn about him are that his line of work has, you know, made him blind in one eye and given him permanent tinnitus in one ear. And he clearly finds his job torturous, since he does not hold back talking about how terrible the pain he's gone through as a result of it is. In fact, he mentions that all of his family has died as a result of their first line of work. Even his kids lying to himself that it makes him happy. It's a sad reality for many rabbits and mice, and as much as Ralph tries to downplay his suffering, it's clearly in vain. I mean, we're seeing it right in front of our own eyes. He doesn't hold any animosity towards the viewer, saying it's all good, but he no longer can deny he hates his forced job, that it's a living hell for him. This PSA is heartbreaking to watch, but it's also amazing. It's got dark humor, it's hard to watch, it's got a very intriguing style and an excellent voice actor. There really was no other PSA better suited for my number one pick. And that, ladies, gentlemen, and fellow non-binary daisies, is the end of another video. Like I said, I never make promises I can't keep, and I said I'd get a video out this week, and I did just that. I did two of them, actually. You had Monday's upload, and this one. Well, if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to like, leave a comment, subscribe, and if you've done all those things, join my Discord server, link in the video and description. And if you've done all those things, y'all have a great day. Antonio out. Peace.